finest place in town. Club genius, your IQ will come around. From green to brown, from up to down, from Stalingrad to Vegas. Hey, open up them pearly gates for Club Genius. Look out, hey, seven pillars of Club Genius. When I hear the word culture, I reach for my TV guy. I reach for my TV. I reach for Club Genius. The only place to be. Hey, Club Genius. The only show to see. Mary had a little lamb. Louisiana had food stamp fraud. And you got Club Genius. No cattle mutilations here. Club Genius. Advance. Who's the rare at Club Genius? Club Genius! Club Genius!
And now, the master of Club Genius, Rudy Cheeks! Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much. Well, we'd like to start this show off with a little something of the ordinary tonight, a segment titled, Where Are They Now? The people that have been watching the show since the very beginning probably remember one of the great ultra stars of the show, Ian P. Tracy. You're probably wondering, where is that guy now? Well, Ian P. Tracy and his mother, Pam Tracy, are here tonight, and he's going to come on up here. Come on up here. Let's talk to Ian and Pam and see what they've been up to lately. Here he is, former co-star of Club Genius, Ian P. Tracy, until, of course, we dragged him away for stealing too many scenes. Ian, how you doing? Ian, is that you making those rude noises? This is why we brought him off the air in the first place. I mean, to tell you the truth. Ian, what have you been up to?
Say, not much.
No, you don't kiss the microphone. Just tell me, what have you been up to? Ian, what have you been doing?
Say, you've had some ginger ale.
Had some ginger ale, is that true?
Shy.
He's kind of shy, yeah, that's right. And it's a beautiful Chinese outfit you have here, because you missed the Chinese New Year night. That was a number of weeks ago.
But
if you can take a good
now.
Look at this outfit here, that's really beautiful. That's beautiful. And this hat, too, it's made out of what appears to be incredibly cheap material. I'm not sure exactly what that is, but I know my grandmother used to have a hat like that. Ian, you like that, huh? It's like quite, yeah, we're at a jaunty angle, that's right. Ian, do you want to say something? Do you want to tell the folks what you've been, they really kind of wondering, what have you been doing? You been learning how to talk? Apparently not. Okay, he hasn't been learning how to talk. That's just the kind of guy he is. Ian P. Tracy, man of the world. Okay, Ian, I want to take a look at that beautiful number 9 on the top of the hat there, denoting the fact that Paul McCartney is dead. Okay, Ian, that's what?
Say hi, Bruce.
That's beautiful. Okay, finally he said hi to me, and of course using my real life name and blowing the whole show. Okay, and well, that's why you're not on the show anymore, but you're still a swell guy, and we love it, and it's glad to have you come by tonight. But you know the name of the first act, Ian? You want to introduce the first act? But the first act is Living with the Bomb, and here they are now, the great man Living with the Bomb, over here. Yeah. Let's hear it for him.
We'll be right back.
Yes. Living with the bomb, living with the bomb. And I want to tell you, fellas, I think that was one of the finest examples of lip syncing I've seen in a long time.
I'm from the Joe Thomas School of Lip Syncing.
The
old Wingding show. We watched it. We studied it very closely.
Lloyd Thaxton, of course. In the Baltimore area, it was Buddy Dean. I know a lot of you people out there. Not from Baltimore. Neither am I. I just happen to know that fact. That's that kind of guy. Okay, why don't we introduce some of the... Why don't you guys introduce yourselves?
All right, my name is Jack Movie.
Jack Movie.
Yeah, Charles Martel.
Charles Martel.
Hi, my name's Bob.
It's Bob. Hi, Bob.
Bugsy Malone.
Bugsy Malone. Okay, probably phony handles, but that's all right. You fellas have been together for about how long? 5-6 minutes? What?
Yeah, at least.
I
followed you. I don't remember.
Did anybody get picked up hitchhiking? Anything like that? This is a new group. We try to bring the latest, newest bands.
Almost as big as Jesus Christ.
Whoa! This guy's just trying to get a little bit of controversy going. It's worked before and beautifully, but I don't think it's going to work.
Because there's a lot of Johnston High School kids out there, and we don't want to influence them at all.
Okay, we don't want to influence any of the high school kids out there. This is basically senior citizen type music, and you guys have got a real good senior following out there. Okay, Jack, well, listen, have you guys got another number?
Sure do.
I'm glad to hear that. Okay, that's good. That's really good, because we had that on our time, according to my watch that I'm not wearing. We had this schedule. So let's go now, Living with a Bomb, and the name of this song is?
It's called It's Not Good, It's Too Bad.
It's Not Good, It's Too Bad. Okay, Living with the Bomb. Living with a Bomb, How Well I Know. Okay. Sounds like kind of the story of this show. Okay, we're going to go away for a commercial for just a bit, and we'll be right back with two experts on the Mighty Three Stooges. We're going away. Thank you.
Welcome to Leo's Bar and Restaurant in Providence, Rhode Island, where the elite of New England society dine regularly. You will be served by our gracious staff of waitresses, who will see that you are given every courtesy. Our food, which will addict you, is made from the finest materials, and all our meals are prepared on the premises. Our professional bartenders, Gus and Zippy, mix the most delightful drinks, and you will frequently come back for more. Yes, it's Leo's Bar and Restaurant in downtown Providence. Our cup runneth over.
We're back. Finally, we're back here at Club Genius. Okay, just want to make sure we truly were back. And we have with us right now a couple of guys that, well, maybe you've seen them here on the show before, but they basically are something we hadn't mentioned before, experts on the Three Stooges. And as a matter of fact, this week, this coming Monday and Tuesday evening, there'll be a Stooge symposium at a nightclub in Providence. That's right, and that's coming up soon. Watch for that. Next week, Monday and Tuesday, Stooge Symposium. And I have with me right here and now, Bill Flanagan.
It's great to be back, Rudy.
Well, it's good to have you back, Bill. Jim Kelleher. And these guys actually know all about the Three Stooges. Tell me about some of your personal relationship with the Stooges, guys.
Well, of course, there was the Curly Lookalike contest that I won. That was really sort of my introduction to the whole thing.
Right, that apparently was, what, last week? No, it couldn't have been. It must have been years ago, right, Bill?
I was only a couple of weeks old, yeah. But really, I guess it's you who got us into the Stooges, isn't it, Rudy? I mean, you just needed a couple of people to get up there on the panel with you so you could make a small fortune.
My arm still hurts from being twisted up my back, as a matter of fact.
Hey, fellas, you know what I mean? It's just not really that, you know, it's just one of those things that keeps me alive. But I thought you guys were having a good time.
We're having a great time. No, these Stooges symposiums, I know I get stopped on the street all over the country from people who've seen. How come you don't mention the nightclub? Is there some sort of taboo on that?
The nightclub is one up in Providence. Get to that nightclub immediately. I mean, well, and camp out there until Monday, I guess, because it might be tough to get in. But if not, just at least get there on Monday night, 9:30, Tuesday night, 9:30. Get there, it's important. But we did have a member on the panel the first year, Louis Camp, who actually met one of the Stooges at Larry's deathbed, isn't that right?
I think Louis Camp is Joe DiRita, myself.
I think he's too short to be. Well,
Know how tall Joe DiRita was, though.
Everything's relative. The Stooges were all 5'2" or less. So, I mean, you know, Vernon Dent, who looked like the Neanderthal man, was actually probably 5'7" or something. Kind of reasonable like that.
They were short guys. Now, there was a story about when the Stooges were in town, they did a personal appearance at, where was it, Rocky Point, or was it Rocky
Point? They were at Rocky Point, and a kid I know, you know, being about 11 years old and a big Stooges fan, went up to them in the world's largest Shaw dinner hall and asked
that,
for an...
Is that the world's largest?
That's the world's largest.
The world's largest Shaw dinner
hall? I don't know exactly how you define a Shaw dinner hall, but it's certainly biggest one in this state. But he went up to Moe and Larry and whichever pseudo-Curly was there, and trembling, you know, asking for an autograph, and they had bubblegum cards with their names stamped on them, and they like handed it and said, "Get out of here, kid."
Well, no one ever accused the Stooges of being stupid, that's for sure.
Probably charged.
Well, maybe they did. I don't know. I'm really not sure. But anyway, they did make a few appearances in town. And in fact, Louis told me one time, he said, "I went all the way out to Lincoln Park one time because they advertised the Three Stooges. And I went out there, and it wasn't Moe, and it wasn't Larry, and it wasn't Curly." He said, "I'd never seen any of these three guys before in my life." I said, "Well, it's interesting. I think I know those guys."
The real Stooges actually did play Providence on a semi-regular basis at Lowe's. And also Healy.
Ted Healy.
Who was their original boss, originally had a partner, and I, for the life of me, can't remember his name, but before he became Ted Healy and his Three Stooges, it was Healy and whoever, but the whoever was a lifelong resident of Newport, and his
probably
still lives there.
One of the Von Bulows or something.
Well, yeah, Sonny Von Bulow and Christine McIntyre are always
same black
the
bag
same
they
role.
Used to treat Curly, right?
Yeah.
No, it's
Men in Black.
Oh, it's interesting, right? Right. it's interesting. We have a lot of rock and roll on the show, and you guys have mentioned in the past that of course the Stooges had a great influence on rock and roll. I thought maybe you wanted to talk about that.
Yeah, I think that's what attracted a lot of us to the Stooges, those of us who came up in the post-Elvis generation, was that Mo had such an influence on the Beatles' haircuts and everything, and that you know, there was an attempt to kind of get the curly haircut thing going with Ian Drury and some of the skinheads.
And of course, the Larry bit with
Art Garfunkel. Yeah.
Right.
Jimi Hendrix Experience flirted with it, but they couldn't get the real Art Garfunkel Larry. Thing going, but there's been a lot of influence. You know, the lyrics of Steely Dan, a lot of people.
How so? The influence, the lyrics of Steely Dan.
Oh, you know, Curly pushing the thing down the hospital corridor, going, "Is there gas in the car? Yes, there's gas in the car." You know, that kind of thing. It's all over rock and roll, and a lot of people don't recognize it, but subliminally, they see the Stooges and they know that there's something there that reflects their own lives. I think it's the rock and roll connection. It might be something deeper than that.
Well, you know what? I mean. All seriousness aside, you know, the rock and roll connection to the Stooges is the fact that the journalistic press or the powers
the
that
journalistic
be
press.
Yeah, as opposed to
the non-journalistic press, like the ones I work for. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. The ones that don't pay aren't journalists. But you know, they're always telling us who is funny from the quote-unquote classic comedians. You know, and we're told that Laurel and Hardy are cool and to laugh at, and Abbott and Costello are semi-cool to laugh at, and the Marx Brothers are geniuses, and the Ritz Brothers are idiots, and you know, and the Stooges were always by the
right down there with the Ritz Brothers. Right?
Yeah, the wisdom of the ages always put the Stooges at some sort of Cro-Magnon level, you know, and I think it's important that the post-Elvis generation figured out all on their own that the Stooges were much funnier than any of those other
just
people.
Just as they knew that white noise was entertaining, they also knew that poking people in the eyes was highly humorous. That's right.
Yeah. Socially significant.
It's kind of funny when you think of how our generation has taken all the refuse of other generations and just turned it into something really embarrassing.
You two fellows are certainly prime examples of that.
Primate examples.
Primate examples, that's yeah. Right. Now, another thing that you folks out there may not know is that Jim Kelleher also is a singer and songwriter, and he wrote a very touching tribute to the Three Stooges, and I'm going to prevail upon you now to sing that song right here, Jim, okay? Can you? This is a song, well, it's not really Jim's music, as you can see, it's a borrowed music, but it's a beautiful, beautiful tribute to them, and soulfully rendered, and let's have it right here now. Jim Kelleher's touching tribute to the Three Stooges.
To fully appreciate the song, you have to be cognizant of the fact that the Stooges are no longer on the air on a regular basis. Anybody here seen my friend Mo Howard? He's not on TV no more. He threw a lot of pies, but he poked them in the eye. I don't see him anymore. Anybody here seen my old friend Larry? The violin and wild hair. They called him Dr. Fine, and they called him Porcupine. I don't see him anywhere. Anybody here seen my old friend Curly? Has he gone to Niagara Falls?
Niagara Falls.
Whatever will we do without? I don't see him at all.
imagining you alone when more dressed like Hitler. Didn't you long when Joe Del Rita showed his knees and shed a piece? Hey, Mo Larry, Mo Larry the cheese. Anybody seen my old friend Shem? Can you tell me where'd he go? I saw him selling Brito up over the hill with Curly Larry and Mo. Oh, hello.
Touching tribute to the Three Stooges. And I might add that and other Stooge songs will be performed at the Stooge Symposium this Monday and Tuesday. And by the way, we'll also have, I guess, a demonstration of the Stoogely Arts. Speaking of the Stoogely Arts, that was certainly was a Stoogely chord mistake that you made there at the after going out of the bridge.
Well, you have to go to college to learn how to cover those up that smoothly. You know,
and the
beauty of covering up a chord mistake, of course, is waiting for a real expert to notice it
and point it out on television.
Right. Yeah.
That's it. Well, I think that's Stoogely in its own right. And I'd like to thank very much Jim Kelleher and Bill Flanagan for coming along tonight. And we'll see them at the Stooge Symposium. That's right, Monday and Tuesday night at 1UP in Providence, Rhode Island. Be there.
Thanks, fellas.
Thank you, Rudy.
Okay, we're going to take a little break, and we'll be back in just a minute with a member of our staff who has some exciting art. Hey, we make them applaud. Yeah, okay, we're back now, and we're back with a member of our staff who, well, here she is, Susan Holland, who's a camera person sometimes, and also you've done floor directing, you've done the sound. What else have you done on the show?
That's about it.
That's about it. I've covered all the bases, yeah.
Floor directing, sound, and credits.
Credits. She does. She punches up the credits on the Chiron. That's pretty exciting, huh? Well, anyway, Susan also is a video artist of long standing, and she you brought some of the videotapes you did. Can you tell me something about these tapes? You might want to move your microphone too over and closer.
Oh, okay.
That's it. There you go, because it's kind of, yeah, nobody can hear you. That's it. Beautiful.
Well, these videotapes are, you'd think I'd know that, right? These videotapes are approximately 10 years old. They're portions of videotapes, and one of them was shown at the Museum of Modern Art in 1980.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 1980.
And you'll tell us which one. We're going to see one of the ones that was shown at the.
I'm not sure if that's one of the ones we'll see. It was titled "The Physiognomy of Marcel Proust," and I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly either.
No, it's physiology. No, I'm sorry. Okay, yeah, the physiognomy. What?
Physiognomy.
The physiognomy of Marcel Proust. Okay, and okay. Well, let's take a look at these. So we take a look at these tapes. Okay, let's take. And this
great.
Person has no sound, right?
I don't think so. This was a sketch for a later tape.
Okay, well, you can tell me what's going on.
It's just an idea.
Take a look at it.
I really don't understand why we wanted to see this one. This is my friend.
I don't either, personally.
This is my friend Jane. This is an exploration of the video plane. And
she's gluing it together? What?
Yeah, it's. You kind of get the gist of it afterwards. These are two college students playing around with a video monitor, but it's. Yeah, she gets it.
And what is she doing there? Is this?
Well, she's exploring the video plane.
Yeah, but I mean, but what I mean is, what does that mean, Susan? Please. looks like she's putting together a jigsaw puzzle, which is.
It's got to do with, well, the idea of the tape. This is not the tape. This was a sketch for the tape. It had to do with animus and anima. It's a
anima and anima. Well, those two always comes to my mind too.
Yeah.
And it was, of course, produced by Fleet National Bank. Is that?
Yes, that's exactly right.
Excuse me, I'm sorry. I lost it there for just a minute.
They just paid for the research.
I see. And
This is not her animus.
This is some other. This is an anima of the people here.
This was a white boy. Yeah.
A white boy. Yes. Yeah. Apparently he's got all the earmarkings of a white boy. Who is this white boy? Is this some?
I've forgotten his name. I think his name was Jeff. Now this piece runs a lot longer than most of our finished tapes did. I don't think videotapes should be that long. You can tell the quality is excellent. It was made on a half-inch video recorder.
Well, that's nothing new to the show here.
Yep, we did one videotape that was later on the reel by putting two machines side by side and running the tape right across both heads, both recording heads, so you got a double image.
Hmm.
But we're not going to see that one. We're going to see this one.
Okay, and this has got sound.
Oh, this is the physiognomy of Marcel Proust. And okay. This is an explanation of how your facial features affect your personality. But what it's really got to do with.
Nose bridge, you are informed that when its owner feels he has been provoked or insulted.
It's got to do with the superficiality of dilettantism.
Seems to have a lot to do with noses,
concave,
too.
Informs you that its owner is somewhat lacking in industriousness, aggressiveness, and physical energy. He also lacks a high degree of eagerness or anxiousness for a steady diet of hard work.
They like this at the museum. And this was the opening for a tape on an Italian fascist. It was filmed
String
at the Piazza. String Beans, too.
Well,
it was filmed at the Piazza Navone in Rome. And the character was very interesting. I'm not sure if we'll see that portion. This was actually another thing. This is an example of the Pulfrick effect, which is three-dimensional video. You put a dark filter over one eye, and it slows the.
It appears to be water, Susan. Am I?
Yes, this is water on rocks.
Water on rocks.
At Roger Williams Park. Those are wet.
Museum of Modern Art interested in this one?
Not at all. Not at all. These are
water
wet.
Water on the rocks. And
these are wet rocks. And this is a baptismal scene. As I said before, these are portions of videotapes, and it's really hard to get it.
She reminds me of some bars I've been in.
Yeah. There's two left feet. Two right feet.
Oh. Well, that's pretty weird stuff, Susan. And
can I get any applause?
Okay, well, hold on. Let's hear it for her. Susan Holland. Susan Holland and her exciting video art. And now you've graduated to working on this show.
Yep.
Life's just a total bring down, Susan. What can I tell you?
I don't know.
Well, I'm glad you brought your videotapes in. Get back there on the camera so nobody screws up, huh?
Okay. Thanks a lot,
Don't
Bruce.
Forget to unplug yourself.
All right. I'll never forget that.
Okay.
I'm
going to
take it
Holland.
With me.
There she is, Susan Holland. You can see her from the back now. Okay, there she is right now. Well, before we go away, we've got this. Somebody else here, apparently a French-Canadian minimalist shopping bag artist. That's what it says here. Russ Chabot, and Russ is out here in the audience. He's going to have some. We always try to bring the new and exciting artists. Always, Always trying to bring a new and exciting artist in here. Here you go, Russ. Why don't you plug yourself right in?
Thank you.
Always trying to present the most avant-garde and interesting in the world of art. And here's Russ, and what have you got here for us?
Well,
this is, that's upside down, Russ. Nobody's going to hear you that way.
Nobody's going to hear you that way.
They're going to gurgle. Yeah.
Oh, well, you know.
Yeah. Well, this is just a French-Canadian mistake, I guess. Yeah, it's just,
no, that goes on.
Yeah, well, I'll try it on the inside thing.
Try it that way. Up, up. Hey, don't eat, hey.
That's what you said.
Let me just hold it there. I'll just hold it there and show you the thing.
Well, let me show you. Let me show you. There's a little bit of art that I've learned, too. It's called TV art. Let me show you right here. Watch this. So put it right. Yeah, there you go.
Thank you. No problem at all. You're so kind,
Master. Thank you very much.
Mr. Cheeks, you're so kind. You're
okay,
so
well, Russ, it's nice to have you here. And what the hell is French-Canadian minimalist shopping bag art?
It's got the long history there. When I was at the Sacred Heart Academy in the Central Falls, you know, I went to school there with the brothers.
Well, yeah, right.
And the brothers there, they didn't like the way I draw.
They didn't. So
they didn't. So I decided
to learn how to draw like
that. Well, you know, I mean, it's tough being an artist. I'm sure you know that.
Oh, sure.
You know, because you are a comic artist, there you.
Yeah, well, that could be true. Yeah.
It got to be so expensive for me to try to draw, you know, and the way things are today.
Let's take a look at this stuff. Come on, Russ. Let's go. I want to hear this prattle about Sacred Heart. Right, this is
the first one.
That's the first. You can't even see this. Hold on. Let's see if we can get a close-up of this. Can you see this?
That's my backyard.
It looks like a lot of wrinkles.
The early one.
That's okay. Let's see some of the later stuff with color and stuff.
That's
right?
My house.
Okay, here is his house. Can we? Can you see that?
You see that? See the house?
I can't see the house. No, I.
Man,
you can
look.
See it. What?
You gotta acquire the eye. See, your eyes are spoiled by the
color. You're gonna have to acquire more than an eye, pretty real quick too, Russ.
This is some bigger bags.
We're moving into the double bag.
No, those like that's my wife.
Oh.
My car. You want to see my car?
I don't know if I want to see your car.
See the car? My telephone.
The telephone.
That's the presidential.
Like
that's the presidential portrait. That's the president.
You know, put this stuff back in.
I got a special one for you.
Okay, what is it? This is me? Here we go. Close in on this. Startling resemblance, but the eyes aren't always crossed, okay?
Then I got a nude.
Well, this we want to see.
That's my wife from the back.
Okay, here we go. At least we. Can we see that? It was really a good idea
That's the bird that was at my bird feeder this morning. It was touching. So I had to capture it.
The bird. Well, speaking of the bird, Russ, I think right now a lot of the people in the home audience would like to wish you the same, the bird, and wave goodbye, Russ, because this is it for you. Get off the show. Russ Chabot, French-Canadian minimal artist, out of my face. Get out of here. This is another lousy bit on the show. I'm not responsible for some of this stuff.
Thank you. Hello. Chef Muscatel here. Hello. How are you? Chef Muscatel here. I want to show you my new recipe for St. Joseph's Day. I know many of you people out there celebrate St. Joseph's Day recently, and maybe you may think I'm Italian. No, I'm not Italian. I don't know what this accent is. It's just phony. I don't know. Some people think I'm Irish. I do a great Bing Crosby impersonation. When Irish eyes are smiling. It's pretty good, but I know I'm not really Bing Crosby. So I'd like to show you right now our very special St. Joseph's Day meal. Now first you need the vino, of course. Here, I already use this bottle here. You never want to use it unless it's something, you don't want to use it to cook, unless it's something you also would drink. And I would drink that, yes. I would drink that. Now, first thing you want to know about this meal is you want to have the colors of Italy. So what we have here is the red, the green, and the white. Of course, with the white, we have the pasta. Here's the pasta. Now, some people like this kind of pasta. Some people, like Chef Muscatel, like their pasta al dente, okay? So we have it a little more al dente. Well, we mix in some of this with it, too, okay? There we go, with it, pasta al dente. Now, next, you want to put a little bit of the wine on the sauce. And, of course, drink the wine with it. Of course, to make sure the wine is still good, it's still good. Next, you want the red portion on the white. And the red, of course, is the sauce. But now a lot of people go to a lot of trouble. They go, they make it at home, and there's no sense in making it at home. Because I say, you can get it right here out of the jar. Why not take it right out of the jar? And there you go, the sauce. Now this sauce is not exactly ready yet. You need a little bit of the vino here. So we put the vino on there. And it's still good. I tell you, it's still very good. Now, your people are saying, now, what are you going to have? Meatball spaghetti? That's what it is. Meatballs and spaghetti, but you want to have the green. So you have to go to a very special Chef Muscatel type market to get the green meat. You know, you don't get this all over. This is a very special green meatball. I have to, you know, sometimes you people who can't get to those special markets that Chef Muscatel goes to, you probably want to make them, you leave this meat out for 3-4 weeks, and it gets good and green. And you'll be able to make it just like Chef Muscatel's beautiful green meatball. You can see it here, who needs a little bit of the wine. And well, Chef Muscatel says, this is the way to do it. This is a beautiful feast. I say, let's sit down and have some more wine. Just celebrate because you're done with the food. And have a real good time with Chef Muscatel here in his kitchen and beautiful St. Joseph's Day feast. And I serve this to my guests and this to myself. I see you. I see you. But before Chef Muscatel goes, I bring you now a very important artist, Dave Force over here, going to read poetry. Poetry over here, Dave Force. I see you.
I can't.
My arm.
Okay. Incest on the PBS. Say the nuclear family is in distress. Incest, make it with mother. Incest, make it with father. Incest, sister to sister. Incest, brother to brother. Incest to one another. You cannot escape, and it couldn't be better. They say existence. If you bend over, you might break. If you give, they're gonna take, and they're gonna take, and they're gonna take, and they're gonna take a little blood for blood's sake.
Okay.
Dave Force, okay, where's that applause? Where's that mighty applause there for him?
Well, Dave, come on over and meet Bing Crosby. Hi, Dave.
Oh, I have a gift for you. I have a gift for you.
Hi. Well, this is beautiful. Oh, an unhurried view of Erotica. Ralph Ginsburg. Hmm, beautiful. From the old...
Ace Publishing.
Ace Publishing.
Yes. Carl Solomon. His uncle.
Huh. Oh, no kidding.
Yeah.
Ah. Well, so, Dave, you're a younger guy. You're not as old as I am, are you?
No, I don't think so.
I certainly hope not. Anyway, how long have you been writing?
It's about 16, I guess. 16, 15.
It's about 16, yeah.
Didn't have much to do. Didn't know too many girls. Never knew in town. Right. Had to write some poems. No. Right. It's not there.
Pretty. Yeah, and it's pretty, I would say it's quite a feat to read them with sunglasses on. That to me
it's quite a feat. Well, these are prescriptions, so it makes it a lot easier. So.
Oh, okay. Do you actually wear glasses sometimes?
Yeah. Started wearing glasses about the same time I started writing poetry.
Yeah. So. Well, how about that? There must be some kind of connection that we don't know about at this point. Dave, have you been doing some readings other places too, right?
Probably. Yeah, I did one up with Shrimp Cocktail Cabaret, Lisa Mann. Uh-huh. School One, just ALP, which were a lot of fun. I had.
There's not a lot of places to read. There's not too many poetry readings around these days. I mean, you don't see it around here in New York or in the larger cities, but.
Well, if we can't find a place, we'll take it outdoors, I guess.
Yeah. So. Wasn't there some kind of readings in the park in Rhode Island?
We're gonna try and get something together. See what happens. I don't know.
Yeah. Like, are you working with a group of other people, other writers?
Yeah. Well, I'm doing a band together now. Uh-huh. And
is the guitar player. Who is the guitar player, by the way?
Oh, that's James Mulligan.
James Mulligan. James is he going to play in the band with you, or?
Yeah. He's Mr. Neil Sterling's brother from the Detectives.
Oh, I know Neil. Sure.
So keep the nepotism.
You know. Sure. Yeah, he looks like Neil too. Yeah. Come to think of it, except for his eyes are a little bigger. But yeah. Oh, that's great. That's good. And I'm glad that you came on and we had a chance to do this. And we, as I say, we're trying to put inject a little bit of culture into the show here. And
well, I don't know if I helped.
Well, I don't know, but you certainly helped me out with some culture right here, this erotic book here, thanks to Dave
Force. I hope that'll help you out. Yes.
Right. Kay. Well, I think it will help me out. I'm not sure. Dave, do you have any other, anything you could read, sans guitar or...
Not really up to it.
Not really up to it.
Oh, do you have time to kill?
Well, not really. I don't know. Let me take it. No, we don't. We might have you to kill, but get out of here. Get out of here. Get this guy out of here. Dave Force. Thanks a lot, Dave. Nice to have you on here.
Thanks a lot.
All right. Bye-bye, Dave. Okay, Dave Force. And if I can get my sheet back, which tells me what I'm supposed to be doing here. This is foolishness. I'm sorry about this. I'm really sorry about that. Is my sheet down here? Somebody's got it? Huh? Oh, she's got the sheet. Oh, good. Good. What? I want to know exactly what's going on here on the show. You lose track. You know, if I don't, without the sheet of paper, I'm lost, to tell you the truth, folks. I didn't know if Dave was going to read another poem or, gee, if I was going to get a haircut. I didn't know what was going on here. Thank God I got a sheet of paper. It says now, oh, for God's sakes, I can't believe it. We have more poetry. Well, not really. What we do is we have a very special section now, more of an educational type. We had the art, now for the education. This educational section is our producer, Tom Zorobedian, with Dan O'Milo, who is apparently a student of Ireland. Because we didn't do anything last week. No, last week they were upset because we had the salute to Armenia. Tom's an Armenian, of course. And they're saying, why were we ignoring St. Patrick's Day? On St. Patrick's Day, well, listen, we're not going to ignore it. We're just going to be a week late. That's just the kind of people we are. So this week, as a salute to the Irish, we have... Dan O'Milo, a student of Ireland, and our producer, Tom Zorobedian, right over here. Take it away, guys.
Okay. We have Dan here because, you know, we've made some jokes about some ethnic jokes, but we want people in the audience to know that we really aren't prejudiced. In fact, every member of the cast actually is part of an ethnic group. We have Dan here. Now, you've studied Ireland, and you visited, and your people are from Ireland. What county is that?
County Mayo.
Okay.
The Irish county.
Uh-huh.
They speak Irish there.
They do,
still
yeah.
Still speak it. Yep. Yeah. Drink the Guinness, speak the Irish. Very Irish.
Irish are great people, you know, and one thing that the Irish have that we want to talk about a little bit tonight is the great Irish tradition of literature. I mean, they've given us so much, especially in the area of literature, and we thought kind of a way to celebrate that. Dan, who has been studying Ireland since he was a wee lad, actually his specialty is Joyce, and he thought that he'd be willing to read a little bit of Joyce for us. So just a little bit of culture, just so we can show to the people that we're just not always picking on ethnic culture and kind of being cows. We are serious, and we do appreciate, especially the Irish. So if you would read a little bit of Joyce, and I'll just step back here, and okay, you just go right ahead.
James Joyce, Dubliners. The next morning, in order to get even with these hospitable sons of bitches, we presented ourselves bright and early at the door of a Catholic priest. This time I let Joe do the talking. He was Irish, and he had a bit of a brogue.
Joyce, unbelievable, exile.
Very good passage here. He had very soft, blue, green Irish eyes, and he could make them water a bit when he wanted to. A sister in black opened the door for us. She didn't ask us inside, however. We were to wait in the vestibule until she went and called for the good father.
James, Dublin. I love this. Do a little more. This is unbelievable. Yeah. I love this. Okay.
In a few minutes, he came, the good father, puffing like a locomotive. And what was it we wanted, disturbing his likes at that hour of that morning? Something to eat and a place to flop, we answered innocently. And where do we hail from, the good father wanted to know at once. From New York.
Yeah, this is good. Exile, cunning, what was the thing, Joyce? Well, I don't want to interrupt. Yeah. Go ahead.
Then you better be getting back there as fast as you can, me lads. And without another word, the big bloated turnip-faced bastard shoved the door in our face. About an hour later, drifting around helplessly, like a couple of drunken schooners, we happened to pass by the rectory again.
I love the stuff. The literature, the feeling, really, the depth that the Irish have. Well, I interrupted. Go ahead. It's unbelievable. Go ahead.
So help me God, if the big, lecherous-looking turnip wasn't backing out of an alley in a limousine. As he swung past us, he blew a cloud of smoke into our eyes, as though to say, that for you. A beautiful limousine it was, with a couple of spare tires in the back, and the good father sitting at the wheel with a big cigar in his mouth. Must have been a Corona, so fat and luscious it was. Sitting pretty he was, and no two ways about it.
Oh, Joyce, oh, James, Joyce, yeah.
It just transports me back to the old South.
Yeah, well, speaking of that, of course, you remember the time that you and I actually went to Ireland together.
We did.
And we really had a wonderful time. We visited. What we did is we actually met the grandson of James Joyce. And we spoke to him. This film, we have a Super 8 film. We don't have sound in that, but we'll talk over that. Yeah. And also, we did take some pictures of the beautiful Irish children, because they really are, you know, they're famous for that.
Beautiful in the world.
So why don't we just show a little bit of this trip that Dan and I took last year to Ireland. Can we run that? And we'll just...
Very rainy in Ireland.
It is.
The green.
Right.
Many shades of green in Ireland. Beautiful water. Let's see, where are we here now?
Oh,
Which county would this be?
Oh, yeah, that's County Cork.
Looks a little...
County Cork, yeah.
Gee, yeah. I don't remember this in Ireland, Tom.
There we go.
I don't remember going swimming in Ireland.
No,
this
was...
It's kind of cold there, isn't it, Tom?
This was it. This was... where we were, and there's a beautiful
looks
shot.
Looks like the west of Ireland there.
Yeah, that's some of the islands there. It's a lovely country, Ireland, I'll tell you.
I can't figure out for the life of me where the hell it is. Palm trees in Ireland?
No, this was a summer time we
had. I don't remember seeing palm trees in Ireland,
No, this was the southern. Now, here we have, I think, was this the Galway coast? Remember we were there? We had a wonderful time there. We went swimming. And now here's I think, the mayor.
Wait a minute. Tom.
Yeah, this was...
No.
The mayor of Galway took us...
This
took us around on a little ride.
Tom, you have the wrong tape.
No.
This is Jamaica.
We went to Jamaica
3 years ago.
You know, part of the Irish tradition really is comedy, and that's why he's kidding. Now, here are some of the pictures of the Irish children.
Definitely
we have
not
some of them
Ireland,
come up.
Tom.
Now, don't you agree the Irish have beautiful children?
That is not an Irishman right there.
This is it. This is us going down the river Kearney. Here we go.
I could definitely tell you that
now,
it's
this
not
is
an Irish child.
An example
Tom.
Of some of the beautiful, just the faces on the Irish children.
Tom, this was not Ireland. It was cold. And
we did get some sun there. Now, what is this here? Oh, yeah. Okay. There's the, yeah, a little river. We went down the river there. And I think we have a little picture of you coming up here, actually celebrating St. Oh, yeah, here's the mayor of Limerick here, just asking for a donation here. You must remember this trip there, and we had a wonderful time.
I don't remember this part of it at all.
No.
It certainly looks like Jamaica.
No. Well, there's
maybe I had a few Guinnesses and I forgot it.
There is a similarity there. Let's see. We go on a little more. Oh yeah. Now we get some good shots of you with his son. Now there you are. Now this is where we meet James Joyce's grandson. He's James coming up here. Here he is, James Joyce's grandson.
No.
He's a musician now.
I definitely know that's not him. No.
An artist in his own right.
No.
And there you are, Dan.
Where?
Listening to...
Oh. That was that dirty old man in Jamaica, wasn't it?
No. And there we are kissing the... This is the famous Blarney Stone, of course. And this is us trying to kiss the Blarney
Stone. That
wasn't
a building,
Stone.
Tom. No.
Yeah, here we are coming up here, and that's you trying to kiss the bar. You're a little slimmer back then, of course. I think this is before we hit the bars.
Yeah, must have been. Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. Well, that's it. That's our trip
maybe,
to Ireland.
Maybe I missed something.
Dan Zamillo and and that's it. I want to thank Dan for showing us a little bit of that. Thank you.
Fooled you. Thought it was Bing Crosby, didn't you? Okay, that was one of the stupidest things I've ever seen. And if we are not able to get every ethnic group in the world mad at us, we're working at it. At least we're working at it. Somewhat of a it was a show this week, right? I mean, it was a show. It was on TV. It was on for 55, 60 minutes or so. I'd call that a show, okay? So we're going to say... good night right now, I think. And what am I talking about? I don't care. Listen, we're going to be back next week, okay? Is that enough for you? I hope you like it. I hope you loved it. And let's run those credits and listen to this. Listen to that. That's what the people say. This is the people's choice. This is what they believe. They believe in me. Yours truly. Yours truly. What I got. Look at that. They want more. They want more. Next week, we'll be back with a show. That's right.